After the minor success of the mediocre Always, a remake of a film that the director fondly remembered from his childhood, and was probably best kept there too, Spielberg's next scheduled project was set to be something a lot darker and far more sinister than the director would usually dare to direct. A remake of the 1961 classic revenge thriller, Cape Fear. It is of course no surprise to us that the director eventually opted out of this project. The terrifying story of the illustrious Max Cady would go on to be skillfully directed for Amblin Pictures by Martin Scorsese in yet another great pairing with De Niro. Spielberg instead eventually settled on the reimagining of the classic tale of Peter Pan, another film that the director's own sentimental childhood memories fed his urge to recreate, and another that I feel should probably have been left there in the past. Since the mid-80s, Spielberg had sat on the idea of remaking the story of Peter Pan. He worked with composer John Williams for a live-action musical version. But the film was shelved as Spielberg's attraction to the idea diminished. But when first-time screenwriter James Hart wrote a script that saw Peter Pan all grown up, it soon found its way to the director, and he jumped headfirst into the project, assembling an all-star cast of Robin Williams, Julia Roberts, Maggie Smith, Bob Hoskins and Dustin Hoffman, who steals the show in the title role of the evil pirate Captain Hook. There were also a handful of cameos from the likes of Gwyneth Paltrow before she was famous as the young Wendy in the flashback scenes, a cross-dressing Glenn Close as a bearded pirate, Genesis frontman Phil Collins as a detective and George Lucas and Carrie Fisher as the two lovers caught by Tinkerbell's dust and who float up over London while sharing a kiss. But don't look too hard, you'd never be able to tell. The film starts as Peter Banin is watching his daughter's school play. Peter Pan. Just as the onstage Peter Pan declares how he will never grow up, Banin in the audience is taking very important business calls and making plans that coincide with his son's most important Little League baseball game. So, rolling out all the bad dad cliches here, but of course the twist is that this serious businessman is none other than Peter Pan, the boy who would never grow up, did grow up. The concept is an interesting one, but like most interesting concepts, the film's duration outlives the appeal of the concept itself. 2.25 hours seems like a long time for a children's adventure film, and I must admit, watching Hook, it felt even longer. Despite a relatively quick introduction, the film still dragged, so many scenes slowing the film's pace to a crawl, leaving me and my 7-year-old son restless. The scene where the children were captured by the infamous Hook should have been one of great terror, and although it was shot in such similar style to the abduction scene in Close Encounters, it seriously lacked any real dread or tension. It's actually when we arrive in Neverland that the film loses its edge. The fantastic set design for Neverland, filmed inside a soundstage at Sony Studios, unfortunately never fully convinces us that it's part of a real world. Even the director himself admitted that he was unhappy with how it looked, and stated that if it had been filmed now, obviously CGI sets would have added to the reality. By the time we meet the Lost Boys, I really begin to lose interest quick. A lot of cringeworthy child performances, and a lot of mindless wailing and cheering. Thrown in for good measure is the comedy character of the lovable fat kid, like Chunk in the Goonies, allowing us all the pleasure of laughing at childhood obesity. Their new leader, Rufio, a cross between Michael Jackson in Bad and Adam Ant, is at loggerheads with the aged Pan, and leads us into a horrible scene where the two hurl a vast amount of creative insults to each other, great fodder for our kids, including Robin Williams calling his young rival a near-sighted gynecologist. Hardly convenient for a children's film. There's many moments in the film that don't sit right, and one of the most notable is the weird love scene between Tinkerbell and the grown-up Pan. If anything, it slows the film and seems completely unnecessary as a whole. Also, the usual zany performances we come to expect from Robin Williams go beyond that and into the moronic as he finally realises that he really is Peter Pan. There is also something inherently wrong with watching Robin Williams flying around in tights with a load of kids. A lot of the effects look very dated by now, which I find is a shame really, especially as this is at a time before CGI and when all involved should have had the superimposing of special effects down to a fine art, as many previous films from Star Wars to Batteries Not Included had managed fine. Hook is sentimental pap, but with Spielberg at the helm it is at least sentimental pap made relatively well. My son seemed to enjoy it, but for me, the film reminds me of a time when Spielberg just couldn't seem to recreate the magic of his earlier films, despite the elements and the themes that the director marvelled in all being there in abundance. Whereas the director's earlier work reflected on his own relationship with his father, and therefore the mother had always happened to be the stronger character, some may argue that here in Hook, the frayed relationship between father and son more accurately reflects his newfound role as a parent, whose obligation to his work meant that he wasn't always there to spend time with his children. But in the end, the father comes through this time, re-establishes his childhood fantasies and the severed bond between his son. Music of John Williams is a saving grace, hardly as notable as many of the scores that he had produced before, but with so many variants of moods and themes portrayed in this overlong film, it is another excellent demonstration of why the composer is one of the most highly regarded in the industry. Three of the musical numbers from the Peter Pan musical remake that Spielberg and Williams collaborated on in the 80s managed to find themselves in the final cut of Hook, none of them, however, especially great. Despite a backlash from the critics, Hook was actually a great success in the box office and is still one of the most successful pirate-based films ever made. It was nominated for a handful of Oscars, none of which were Best Director, but alas, it won none. Well, that's about all I've got time for. Thanks again for tuning in. Feel free to leave a comment below, give us a thumbs up, and if you haven't already, please subscribe. Thank you. Good night.